The text we'll be studying this morning is Matthew chapter 6, verses 19 through 21. And last week I heard Deacon Abel make mention of it, so I was glad that knowing that I'd be preaching this text and hearing the Lord was already previewing it for us. But listen as I read Matthew 16, verses 19 through 21. Jesus speaking, "Do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy, and where thieves break in and steal. But lay up treasures for yourselves in heaven, where neither moth nor rust destroy, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." Well, before we examine this text closer, I just want to start off by saying good morning. It's a blessing to see you all and to be with you, to worship the Lord and to share His word with you. And I pray that it will encourage you, that it will challenge you, and it will make you more like Him. We're going to be looking this morning at how God wants us to invest His resources for His kingdom. Sometimes we get a little confused. We may get a paycheck and think, "Oh, I got my paycheck, and I'll take it home to my place. Maybe I drive my motorcycle or my vehicle." But in reality, everything belongs to God. All resources He gives are His, including even our gifts. Whether we have a sharp mind, perhaps, it might be an ability to speak, or hospitality, or to show mercy, or boldness and confidence and skill in sharing the gospel, loving others, the gift of faith, whatever it might be, it's all from God. And God wants us to use it. He wants us to invest it into His kingdom. And as I was studying Jesus' sermon here in Matthew chapter 6, verses 19 through 21, and this sermon starts back in chapter 5, but as I was studying this passage, I was reminded of an unfortunate old saying. Maybe you've heard this saying. Let me know if you've heard this. I remember hearing this when I was younger. I've heard it several times in my life, but it goes like this: don't be so heavenly minded that you're no earthly good. Have you ever heard that statement? Don't be so heavenly minded, don't be so fixed and focused on heaven that you're no good in this world. Well, that's a very sad statement. And I think as we look at this text together, we're going to see that it couldn't be further from the truth and God's desire for us. You see, it's easy to get so caught up in life on this earth that we fail to live for eternity. A better way to say that statement might be, don't be so earthly minded that you're no heavenly good. That's more in line with Scripture. Don't be so heavenly minded. Don't be so earthly minded. Don't be so focused on this world that you're no heavenly good. Too many are focused on living for today and not looking at eternity. And having an eternal kingdom mindset is illustrated in a little story I came across I thought was interesting. There were some Christians who were traveling in the Middle East, and they heard about a wise, devout, beloved old believer, so they went out of their way to visit him. Now, my mission that I'm a part of is called Grace Ministries International. We have missionaries in Lebanon and in Arab-speaking countries. And so I understand when you hear that you're in that area and you hear, there's a strong believer in the area, you'll go out of your way to visit them because they might be few and far between. There are actually places where you might stand in a city of 100,000 or more, and the reality and the wake can hit you that, wow, I'm the only Christian in this entire city. And they heard of a godly man as they were in the Middle East, and so they decided to visit him. And when they finally found him, they discovered that he was living in a simple hut. All he had inside was a rough cot, a chair, a table, and a battered stove for heating and cooking. The visitors were shocked to see how this man of God had so few possessions. One even blurted out, he said, "Where's all your furniture?" The aged saint replied to him gently and asked, "Where's yours?" The visitor was a little shocked by that as well, and he responded, "Well, it's at home, of course. I didn't carry it with me. I'm traveling." This wise old saint said, "So am I. So am I." As we invest our lives in God's world, God wants us to be heavenly minded. However, many Christians, sad to say, are so earthly focused, they're no heavenly good. People have many excuses. They've made many excuses over thousands of years for not investing in God's kingdom or serving Him and serving others, particularly when it comes to missions and evangelism and making disciples. Here are a few excuses that some people have made over the years. Well, you know, we'd really like to reach these people here. They've got a great need, but we just can't afford it. So we're really helpless. Another excuse that people might use is, well, you know, I'm just not called to get involved. That's not my calling. That's for somebody else. Others would say, you know, I feel for them. I feel the need. I see the need, but, you know, I just don't feel equipped to witness or disciple, share with anybody. I understand the gospel. It was shared to me, but I don't think I could tell that to anybody else. Others have said, you know, I want to help someday, but first I got to get my family set up. Then I got to get my business taken care of or my career established. But after that, I assure you, someday I'm going to get to investing into God's kingdom. Probably the most common is, you know, I just don't have the time. I'm too busy. Too caught up in life in this world. Well, many, many more excuses could be given for not investing in God's kingdom. And our passage is set in the midst of a sermon from Jesus where he gave several commands for those who could understand and hear his message on investing in God's kingdom. But first, he had to deal with some wrong thinking from the Pharisees. They thought they were investing in God's kingdom, but they had wrong thinking. The Pharisees thought that God would reward their religious acts, not realizing that their hearts were not right. They were focused on earning rewards on earth instead of heaven. Jesus warned, "Beware of practicing your righteousness before other people in order to be seen. In order to be seen by them, for then you will have no reward from your Father who is in heaven." In this sermon, Jesus described the kind of righteousness that God will reject, like the Pharisees' self-righteousness, their misguided thinking that they could please God through their actions, or they gave and did things for people, but not for God's glory, but for their own. And so God, in this passage, Jesus taught the kind of righteousness that God rejects and the kind of righteousness that God indeed will reward. And it's evident that God is looking forward. Have you ever thought of that? God is looking forward to rewarding us. Anybody ever buy someone a Christmas present or a birthday present here? Just me? Okay, I see a smile. Okay, well, okay, two of you, great. So me, the smiling couple, and you other two, we've given gifts to people at Christmas. I don't know about the rest of you, but sometimes I can't stand waiting. I've got seven kids, and I buy something that I know they're going to really be blessed by, and I can't wait to give it to them. My daughter's like that. She's like, oh, Daddy, can I give it to you now? It's not Christmas yet. It's not Christmas. Just wait, honey. It's Christmas Eve. Can I give it? No, let's wait till tomorrow. I enjoy giving gifts. I think that's something in our hearts because our Father enjoys giving us gifts and wants to reward us. He wants to reward us for things done for His glory with the right heart and the right attitude. Jesus said that His people will be rewarded for being persecuted in Matthew chapter 5, verses 12. If we suffer for Christ, if we stand for Him and are persecuted, He's got rewards waiting for us. He also said we're going to be rewarded if we love our enemies in chapter 5, verse 46. When our enemies revile us, when they hurt us, when they steal from us, when they put us down, and we love them in return. There's going to be rewards for that. Jesus said we'll be rewarded for helping the needy in Matthew 6, 4. He said that we'll be rewarded for righteous prayers in Matthew 6, verse 6. And then finally, in Matthew 6, 18, He said we'll be rewarded for righteous fasting. Fasting done with the right motives and the right hearts. And this is why Jesus gave the following instructions for proper investing in God's kingdom in Matthew 6, 19 through 21, where He said to store up treasures in heaven. And from these verses, we learn three compelling reasons why we should be investing in God's kingdom. This is what I want to make sure that you get today. Let me make sure I get to... There we go. All right, so... If you don't remember everything I'm saying, which you won't, here's the three points that I really want to fasten to your hearts today. Three compelling reasons why we should, why we must invest in God's kingdom. First, investments made in this world only yield temporary rewards. Even good things that might be helpful to others, if they're not done for God's glory, the rewards are only temporal. A second reason that we need to invest in God's kingdom is investments made for His kingdom yield eternal rewards. So investments, if I didn't say that right the first time, investments made in the world are temporal. Investments made in God's kingdom yield eternal rewards. And a third reason why we should invest in God's kingdom is because investments made in His kingdom reveal our love for God. It shows it to Him. It shows it to the world. It's a testimony to those that, wow, this person is willing to sacrifice and give up things that they have because they believe Jesus is so worth it. And it causes people to go, why? Why is Jesus so important to this person, to this man, this woman, this child? Why are they willing to give up their time, their talent, and their treasure for this person? What is it about Him? And that is one way that people are drawn to Christ. Not the only way, but it's one. So let's look at this first one now. The first compelling reason why we should invest in God's kingdom. And that's that those investments that are made in this world, instead of His kingdom, are going to only yield temporary rewards. We see this in verse 19. All investments of God's resources that are focused on this life will eventually be gone. Now we have a funeral, or I guess it wouldn't be a funeral, what would you call that? A cemetery, just a block from here. I've been there for some burials before, and I've seen many processions coming down, I think it's Pitois Zone, You'll see many jeepneys, people walking behind. I'm sure you've seen that. I've seen it up and down Ortigas and many different streets. Have you seen that, or is it just me? Okay, so we've seen these processions. Have you ever seen a hearse driving by with a person who's departed with a trailer attached to it carrying their possessions? Has anybody seen that? I don't think so, right? There's an old saying. They have a lipat bahay. You never see a U-Haul trailer. That would be a lipat bahay service. But you never see a hearse carrying a trailer full of the person's possessions. Why is that? Because they can't take it with them. Everything they worked for, everything we accumulate in this world is going to perish. Even if we leave it to our children and our grandchildren, it's eventually going to be gone. That's why it's so foolish to labor for the temporal. In Jesus' sermon on a Galilean mountainside, he spoke to the crowds about the kind of righteousness that God rewards. Rewards that last forever. And he told them, don't lay up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break in and steal. Has anybody ever had anything stolen from them? I've had several things stolen over the years. I remember the frustration I had at one time growing up when I was maybe 20, and they broke the window in my car to steal my stereo. My stereo was worth about 2,000 pesos, but the window was 5,000 pesos. And then the lock they broke. I had another one, they broke the lock. They just put a screwdriver in it. Those things cost more than the stereo or the tools they stole in my car one time. All the things that we lay up, we store up, that we collect in this world are just passing away. This word to lay up or store up also has the idea of hoarding. And I think that's human nature. I don't know why that is, but we tend to collect things. People collect things like shoes. I won't say a name, but I know someone right now here that's going, oh, shoes, they got me. Maybe if I haven't got you yet, how about this? Purses. Comic books, DVDs, artwork, coins, pens, shells, rocks, antiques. I'll tell you my kasalanan. I collect Starbucks mugs. Whenever I travel, I have one from New Zealand and India. I got one from Venice, Hong Kong, Tokyo. All over, I collect them. Why do we do that? It's for some reason, it's in our nature. We collect things. And Jesus is warning here. He says, don't collect and hoard things for yourselves. Now, it's not wrong to have possessions. God blesses us and gives us possessions. The problem is when those possessions possess us, when we're preoccupied by them, when we live and work for those things. Scripture talks about having possessions and it being blessed by God and it being a good thing. It talks about leaving an inheritance for even your grandchildren. We're given responsibilities to take care of family, to take care of neighbors, to take care of churchmates. So it's not a sin to have resources. It's about how we use them. God doesn't want us to stockpile them well beyond our needs. And he doesn't want us to stockpile or hoard resources because we're worried that he's not going to take care of us in tough times. This is a problem for Americans. They have insurance for everything. So it's okay. Oh, my house burned down. Oh, Cy Young. It's a good thing I have insurance. You know, oh, I fell and injured myself. It's a good thing I have medical. I have dental. I have renter's insurance. I have home insurance. I have fire insurance. I have earthquake insurance. God wants us to be good stewards, but He wants our trust to be in Him. He blesses us with resources, not to stockpile, but to bless others and to build His kingdom. During His exceptionally long ministry, which spanned most of the 18th century, a man named John Wesley, perhaps you've heard his name, perhaps you've sung some of his songs, he earned a considerable amount of money. He published many sermons and other works, and he was a popular author and preacher. So he made a lot of money off of that. Yet, when he died, I did a rough conversion into pesos, and I know this was a few hundred years ago, but he left roughly about 2,000 pesos when he died. That's what he had left. He probably made millions, but he only left a few thousand pesos because he continually gave what he earned for the Lord's work. I'm sure when he died and stood before the Lord, he didn't go, "Oh, Cy Young, I had 1 million or 10 million pesos still left in the bank. I should have spent that while I had the chance." I don't think he regretted it or felt that way at all. I'm sure he felt, "I'm glad that I only had a couple thousand pesos left because I used most of what the Lord had given me for His work and His glory." Well, in response to the misuse of God's resources, Jesus commanded, again, this verse 19 is a command, and He said, "Stop. Stop storing up treasures for yourself on earth." And that's the key word, yourself. If we're having resources, perhaps we're storing some up to bless others, maybe to help plant a church somewhere, some missions work, youth, some kind of ministry, taking care of our family within reason. That's all fine, but to store it up in an ungodly way, which we'll see an example in a minute, Jesus said, stop doing that. He warned against storing up treasures that are focused on our own benefit and our own desires instead of God's and His kingdom and instead of our neighbor's needs. Scripture itself offers, I think, the best illustration of how God feels about poor stewardship and management of His provisions, of His resources. He told this parable in Luke chapter 12, verses 16 through 21, if you want to jot this down. Luke chapter 12, verses 16 through 21, Jesus told this parable, which is very convicting. Luke 12, verse 16, "The land of a rich man produced plentifully." It'd be, if we made this a modern parable, we might say a man's investments or his salary was really, really nice. He was pulling down a lot of money, or he had a lot of return on his investments. And he thought to himself, "What shall I do? I have nowhere to store all these crops or all this money, all these properties I've acquired." So in this parable, the man said, "I will do this. I will tear down my barns and build larger ones. And there I will store all my grains and all my goods. And I will say to my soul, 'Soul, you have ample goods laid up for many years. Relax, eat, drink, and be merry.' But God said to him, 'Fool, this night your soul is required of you. And the things you have prepared, whose will they be? What will happen to them? You certainly won't get to enjoy them anymore.'" Verse 21, So is the man, so is the woman who lays up treasures for themselves and are not rich toward God. So what did Jesus mean when he said, do not hoard up or store up treasures? Was he just talking about money? It's pretty much what I've focused on so far, but it's not. That's not what he's talking. It's not limited to money. D.A. Carson wrote that storing up treasure in heaven refers to whatever is of good and eternal significance that comes out of what is done on earth. Let me say that again. Storing up treasure refers to whatever is good and of eternal significance, or has eternal significance and consequences, that is done on this earth. And I agree. And I believe that Scripture makes it clear that the resources God entrusts to us, the resources he entrusts to me and to you, includes our time, our talent, and our treasure. And the way we use all of these things, the time, talent, and treasure that results in things that are eternal and things that are in heaven, those are the resources that Jesus wants us to store up, not for ourselves, but for his kingdom. Here's a few examples we see in Scripture. Ephesians chapter 5, verses 15 and 16. Ephesians 5, 15 and 16 says, look carefully then how you walk, not as unwise, but as wise. Let me restate that. Carefully walk as wise men and women of God, making the best use of your time, because the days are evil. The days are evil. We have a limited amount of time in the day and until Christ comes. So he says, make the best use of that time. It's a gift from God to us. Every heartbeat, every breath, every second of time that passes is a gift from him. And he wants us to be good stewards of it. He wants us to have a good balance of using it to care for our bodies and to rest, to spend time with our families, to spend time using the gifts he's given us to serve each other in this church, and using his resources to advance his kingdom in the world. An example of using our talents in a way that would honor God rather than storing them up for things in this earth can be found in 1 Peter 4:10. In this sense, using our talent, I mean the idea of our gifts, our skills that God has given us. In 1 Peter 4:10, he says, each of us has received a gift. Use it to serve one another as God's stewards, as God's managers of God's various graces. I don't know if you've ever thought about it in these terms, but every one of us who is a follower of Jesus Christ has been given at least one spiritual gift, if not several. But the gifts are not given for us. He's given us gifts, maybe better said, through us he's gifted the church. Through each one of us he's given gifts to the body to build each other up. So if we're not using the gift that he's given to the church through us, we're actually robbing each other. We're actually being selfish of the gift that God has blessed the church with and made us stewards with. Everyone has a gift, and he wants us to use it for his kingdom and his glory, for our neighbor's good. An example of using our treasure in a God-honoring way, and this also has an example of treasure squandered, Luke chapter 19, verse 12 through 23. Jesus tells another parable, Luke 19, 12 through 23. Jesus said, therefore, a nobleman went into a far country to receive himself a kingdom and then return. Calling 10 of his servants, he gave them 10 minas, units of money, and said to them, engage in business until I come. When he had returned, having received the kingdom, he ordered these servants to whom he had given the money to be called to him, that he might know how they had gained or what they had gained by doing business. The first came before him saying, Lord, your mina has made 10 more. And he said to him, Jesus or the master, well done, good servant. Because you have been faithful in very little, you shall have authority over 10 cities. And then the second came, Lord, your minas made 5. I've invested them. I've doubled them. And he said to him, and you are to be over 5 cities. Then the last came. Another came saying, Lord, here is your mina. Here's the one mina that you gave me, which I laid away in a handkerchief. I hid it. I kept it safe. The master was very angry. And he said, why? Why then did you not put my money at least in the bank? If you weren't going to at least use it and try to make more, you could have at least just stored it in a bank instead of in a handkerchief or a hole in the ground. Then at least at my coming, I could have collected interest. And then Jesus rebuked him for being a poor steward, an unfaithful servant, not investing God's resources. Instead, he hoarded them. Well, because we've been entrusted with time, talent, spiritual gifts and skills, and we've been entrusted with treasures from God, he expects that we do not waste them on earth, which is set to perish. To illustrate the temporal nature of this world and everything that's in it, Jesus pointed out that everything that is stored up, everything that is cherished, everything that is labored and sweat and toiled for faces the same future of deterioration and loss. He said in Matthew 6:19 that moth and rust and thieves will be their fate. MacArthur wrote that even if we keep our possessions perfectly secure during our entire lives, we are certainly separated from them at death. Many millionaires will be heavenly paupers. Many people who are rich, many Christians that are rich in this world will be poor in heaven. And many paupers will be heavenly millionaires because of the way they stewarded God's resources. And this brings us to a second compelling reason. A second compelling reason why we should invest God's resources in God's kingdom. First, because everything invested in this world will perish. But secondly, we should invest our resources in God's kingdom because those investments will yield eternal rewards, as it says in verse 20. Unlike the temporal nature of treasures that are built up in this world, stored up, hoarded in this world, treasures stored up in heaven will have unending blessings and bring us unending joy. And probably more importantly, will bring our master eternal joy as well. After commanding believers to stop focusing their use of God's resources on themselves, on this side of heaven, Jesus said instead, lay up treasures for yourself in heaven, not on earth, but in heaven, where neither moth nor rust destroys, and where thieves do not break in and steal. So instead of selfishly storing up what God has given us to manage, God wants us to be generous. He wants us to be generous with His resources by giving a portion towards the building up of His kingdom and advancing His gospel. Rather than being so caught up in the stress and the temporary things in this life, He wants us to keep our eyes fixed on Him. I've had a few issues in the last few months. I don't want to make myself the hero of the story. I'm not. I'm a sinner like everyone else, and I struggle to do what I'm preaching. I've been caught up many times in my circumstances. Some people would consider my water bill on the high side. It's usually 2,000 to 3,000 pesos a month. We had a pipe burst under our house. We didn't even know. We can't see any evidence, but we got a Manila water bill for 42,000 pesos for the last 3 months. At the same time, we went and paid our property tax. The city government told us, oh, we're sorry. We just noticed that we haven't taxed you for your structure. You owe us taxes for your house for the last 9 years. We're still waiting for that total. My car is having problems, and it's going to be 100,000 pesos to repair. And my printer broke down. I've got all this stuff happened just in the last few weeks. And it can be so easy to get caught up. People have lost loved ones. Makes my little temporary things seem like nothing. But God doesn't want us to be consumed and caught up in the things that happen in this world, that it takes us off our focus of Him and His kingdom. Remember, He does care about our suffering and our needs, but He wants us to remember that He provides and He takes care of them, and He wants us to be faithful stewards, even during those times. God wants us to give a portion for building up others, for building up His kingdom, and for making Him known to people who have never heard His name, advancing His gospel. And He says in 2 Corinthians 9:7 that this giving should be from the heart. Not simply our duty. Oh, here comes the plate. Or I guess here it's a bag. Oh, people are going to see it. Fine. Or even if it's not begrudgingly, well, it's my duty. I'm supposed to. He wants us to do it from the heart. He wants us to have the attitude, I want to make sure that those who are ministering to us full-time, I'm not, I'm a lay elder, but we've got full-time pastors here. To me, I want to make sure they're cared for. I want to make sure that they can dedicate their lives to ministering to us through the Word, through love, through service. I want to make sure we have a comfortable place where we can come and worship God together. So I'm happy to give. I'm happy to know that our resources, one of the largest parts of the budget of this church, is towards missions. I think it's the second largest. I'm happy to know that when I give, it's being used for God's kingdom locally and globally and abroad. So He wants us to give from a joyful heart. I mean, just on a practical level, let's just think, if you have a special someone, you know, your sweetheart, and it's your anniversary. What would you prefer on your anniversary? Them to go, your sweetheart to go, oh, well, my alarm went off. What is it? Oh, it's my anniversary today. Oh, yeah. Okay. Hey, sweetheart. Here's some flowers. You know, here's some candy. Yeah, guess you know I did what I'm supposed to do. Happy anniversary! So don't be mad at me. On the way home, I stopped at the gas station and I got you a card. You can't be mad. I didn't forget. You know, I did my duty. Or would you prefer someone? The calendar goes off. It's my anniversary at the end of the month. 30 days. I got to start planning. Oh. I'm so excited to celebrate this special time with this special person that God's given me. Oh, what do they love? What do they love to eat? What are their favorite things? I want to show tangibly my love because it's my delight. What would you prefer? Being remembered and loved because it's their duty or it's their delight? I see some heads nodding. I'm hoping it's because, yeah, duty. That's for me too. God also. God wants us to worship Him and love Him out of joy, out of delight, not simply, well, it's my, I good. Went to church, check. Did my devotions this morning, check. gave some offering, check, did my duty, I'm good, we good? No, he wants us to do it from the heart. Lord, I'm so excited that I get to worship you with other believers, and I get to hear your word, prepare my heart, my ears, my mind to understand it. Be with the preacher as he prepares, grow us and stretch us through that. I pray that our singing, our prayers, our worshiping of you, that the children, all of this is a fragrant offering to you. And I pray that you'll use what we give back to you for your glory. That's the kind of joy that God wants us to have when we give. And there's different opportunities that God wants us to use or take advantage of for laying up treasures in heaven. Like in James chapter 1, verse 27, we're told to give to orphans and widows. That's one way we can store up treasures in heaven, to joyfully, not simply dutifully. I'm not dismissing that we do have obligations, but God wants it joyfully. And in James 1:27, it says, pure and undefiled religion before our God and Father is this, to look after orphans and widows in their distress and to keep oneself unstained by the world. That's one way we can store up treasures in heaven, is by joyfully giving to orphans and widows. Another way is to give to those who are in need in general, like James says in the next chapter, chapter 2, James 2, 15 and 16. James said, look, if a brother or sister is poorly clothed and lacking in daily food, he's giving a hypothetical here, and one of you says to them, go in peace, be warm, be filled, I'll pray. Oh, wow, yeah, I can hear your stomach growling. Whew. You sound really hungry, and you look like you need a shower, too. Yeah, don't come any closer. And boy, weren't you wearing those clothes yesterday? And the day before that, and the day before that? I'll be praying for you, brother, sister. Be warm, be fed, yeah. James says, if you say, go in peace, be warm, be fed, without giving them the things they need for their body, what good is that? James exhorts us to have the kind of faith where we truly love and care for and help each other in need. Another way to store up treasures in heaven besides taking care of orphans and widows and those in need is giving to our pastor elders. I'm specifically talking about our vocational ones. Some of us elders are blessed to have jobs and be cared for that way, and some of us are blessed to have jobs here to care for all of us. You ever thought of what a privilege that is? Like, can any of you read the Bible for hours throughout the day and study and read, not only read the Bible and prepare to teach it, but read other books in the Bible and then meet people for hours and share about Christ, go to Bible studies, go to campuses? Does anybody here get the time to do that all the time? We can't, right? We got to eat. We got to work. We got family to take care of. But thank God that he allows us to pool together to support a few men so that they can dedicate themselves to the word and our care and managing us and helping us reach our community for Christ, to help strengthen our families and our homes. So I'm excited to help support our pastor elders so that they can do those ministries and take us deeper in the word than we have time to do. 1 Timothy 5, verses 17 and 18, it talks about that. This is another way we can store up treasures in heaven, by caring and supporting our ministers. 1 Timothy 5, 17 and 18, Paul, writing to his son in the faith, Timothy, he said, let the elders who rule well be considered worthy of double honor. So we're to honor our elders with not only our lips and the way we speak to them and treat them, but tangibly as well. Especially those who labor in preaching and teaching, he said. For the scripture says, you shall not muzzle an ox when it treads out the grain. Now some of you are going, what is this ox and grain stuff doing here? What does that have to do with anything? He's talking about, you know, giving double honor to elders, and all of a sudden he's talking about animals? What's going on? Well, they understood that well in the Bible times. I mean, it's funny, as I talk to friends like my Bianan, my father-in-law, he's from Cavite. He's getting close to 80. He says he remembers Makati years ago was just all open fields. Ortigas Center was all fields and hardly any buildings. It was like this around Jerusalem and stuff. You had lots of fields and hills, lots of vineyards and crops and animals, and people were very familiar with that. And they were used to seeing the ox in the field pulling the plow. And he's saying here, you know, when you have an ox working in the field, you don't cover its mouth and prevent it from eating and drinking. When it's working, it should be able to take advantage of that. It should share in some of the blessing. It should be allowed to eat some of the produce, the crops of the field, drink some of the water thereby, rather than keeping it muzzled. And he says, like that, like an animal who's laboring for your benefit, don't muzzle it, let it enjoy the fruits of its labor. The same thing with our elders. They deserve double honor. Take care of them. And then he ends this 1 Timothy 15 in verse 18 now. The laborer deserves his wages. It's funny, as we talk a lot of times about pastors, we give them a love gift. It's not really a gift. They've earned it. They deserve it. They work hard if they're good elder pastors. And that's a way we can store up treasures in heaven, by caring for them. Now, I'm not paid by the church, so I'm not making a case for me. That's what Scripture says, and I'm just expositing it to you. Another way we can store up treasures in heaven is by giving for church planting and missions. We had the privilege of having Pastor Vernon here in July. He's one of our church planters. We've got a church plant in Antipolo, and Lord willing, God will use us to be the catalyst and to help in some ways to plant other churches as well. And in 3 John, verses 5 and 8, we see that giving for church planting and missions work, if we have the right heart and attitude, stores up treasures in heaven. 3 John, starting in verse 5, "Beloved, it is a faithful thing you do in all your efforts for these brothers." The brothers he's talking about is some church planters, some missionaries that have come to the believers there, and they're caring for them. He says, even though they're strangers as they are, verse 6, "they testified to your love before the church. They reported to us your care of them. You will do well to send them on their journey in a manner worthy of God. For they have gone out for the sake of the name, accepting nothing from the Gentiles. Therefore, we ought to support people like these, that we may be fellow workers of the truth." Let me read that last verse again, talking about these church planters that have come to their church. They're caring for them. They probably put them up in their homes and they fed them because they were going out for the sake of his name. Verse 8, he says, "Therefore we ought to support people like these, that we may be fellow workers for the truth." When we support and send church planters and missionaries, and when they bear fruit, it's not just their reward. Pastor Vernon in Ormoc, the work the Lord's doing through him there, some of those rewards are going to be to our account as well, because we're a part of his support team, along with other churches and individuals who are praying for them and helping financially support them for God's kingdom. When we joyfully give with those things in mind, with the right heart and attitude, we are laying up treasures, rewards in heaven that are eternal. So when does using our time, talent, and treasures produce rewards in heaven? Well, when we look back at verse 18 of Matthew 6, we see Jesus describing the kind of righteousness that God will reject and the kind who will reward. So if you've got your Bibles there, it's not on the PowerPoint, but if you're in Matthew chapter 6, go back to verse 2. And this will help us see some of the context here. This is Jesus' sermon as he's calling out these hypocritical Pharisees who are trying to earn rewards by giving for the wrong reasons and praying for the wrong reasons and fasting for the wrong reasons. And in Matthew 6, verse 2, it says, "When the people help those in need so that they can be praised by others," Jesus said, "they've received their reward already." They can't expect, those Pharisees who were helping the needy, they would do a big show, you know. I remember seeing this once, and I felt so bad. I used to work with some squatters. They lived under a Manalo Bridge in Mangahan, and there was a lady living around the block, and every year at the same time, she would go up to her balcony and throw coins down to the people living under the bridge. So they'd all gather in front of her house, and I hated seeing this. Some old ladies that we were ministering to, Ate Dora, a woman, I love her, and I just felt so, she picks up her dress and she's holding it out to catch the coins. Very undignified. I'm thinking, you know, if you really want to help this woman, come down. Maybe invite her into your house and give her some money and then the people there. But she wanted to make a big show so that you had crowds around the house and people are jumping, men, women, and children fighting for coins. And she had these big statues all over the house and in the yard. That was her reward already. There was no reward for her in heaven waiting for that as a result of that. She got her reward. Their temporary joy in getting those few coins and maybe a few pieces of bread for that day, that was her reward and nothing else. And anyone who gives to help the needy with the wrong heart and motives, that little act right there, that's the extent of the reward. And then in verse 5, Jesus talks about people who pray for the wrong reasons, with the wrong heart, the wrong motives. The Pharisees would have these long, flowing robes. Sometimes when they're about to pray, they'd have people would clang these little cymbals, they'd blow horns, and nice and loud prayers for everyone to hear. And people would be going, "Wow, look at the," you know, it's almost like walking the red carpet during the Grammys or something. "Look at the outfit, and wow, everything's done up nicely. Went to the best schools, the best clothes. He's so wealthy. God is obviously blessing him." And listen to those prayers. They're so eloquent. Jesus said when people pray for the purpose of being seen by others, they've already received their rewards. And in verse 16, he dealt with fasting. When people fast to be seen by others, they've already received the rewards. He talks about how, he says, rather than go there, the Pharisees would mess up their hair and wouldn't brush their teeth and be all unkempt and, "Oh, what's wrong with you?" "Oh, nothing, nothing. Are you sick?" "No, no, no." "All right, yeah, I'm just fasting. I'm fasting." That's what it is. You know, that's their reward. That's why I know some churches that regularly practice. They have it on their calendar every year, the same time of year, they do their church-wide fasting. Fasting is a good thing. And there are times that God calls us to do that. But if it's a pre-programmed thing in the church where everyone, "Hey, this is our fasting week," and "Hey, look at Facebook, here's me at the restaurant, I'm not having anything, my friends are all eating, but I'm not because I'm fasting," they've received the reward already. But if you're fasting because you want to set time apart, you want to be remembered every time you hunger and that hunger pain hits you, you want that to remind you privately, "I'm doing this because I want to have some special focused time and be reminded that I'm praying for God and His glory. I've got something heavy that needs prayer right now. Maybe we have a new church plant, a situation in my family. I want to spend some focused time in prayer." You're doing it for the right reasons. That's the kind of fasting God's looking for. So that's what he says, looking at the opposite now, Matthew 6, verse 4. When you give to the needy in secret, you're not doing it for everyone to see. Your Father who sees in secret will reward you in secret. You will have eternal rewards when you're doing it for the right reasons, not for a show. Or Matthew 6, 8. When you pray in secret, your Father who sees in secret will reward you. And Matthew 6, 18, when you fast in secret, you're doing it for the right reasons. Your Father knows about it. He sees what you're doing in secret or unannounced and unknown to others, and He's going to reward you for that. Well, we've seen two compelling reasons so far for investing in God's kingdom. Firstly, if we invest in this world, those investments are just going to perish. They're temporal. So instead, we should invest in His kingdom, because when we invest in His kingdom with the right heart for the right reasons, then we will be rewarded with rewards that will last forever. And thirdly, if we invest in God's kingdom, it reveals our love for God. People who live a lifestyle of investing their time, talent, and treasure for God's kingdom, God's purposes, the good of His people, for the lost to be drawn to Him, for the building up of the saints, for men, women, and children. Someone who does that as a, I call it a gospel reflex. It's the gospel's transformed your heart. You ever had your knee tapped with a little hammer by the doctor? And it does that? You ever had that happen? Can you stop that? You can. It's called a reflex. They hit it as much as you try. It still does it. A gospel reflex. A person who's truly transformed inside is made new. They've been born from above. We're changing. We're continuing to be more and more like Christ. So when we see someone hurting or needy, we have a gospel reflex. What can I do? Can I help that person? You know, that kid looks hungry. I've got an extra sandwich in my car. I got some crackers. My neighbor, they're sick. Maybe I can help them somehow. Maybe I can cut their grass or do something. It's just natural. You want to. It's an impulse that comes from a gospel reflex, a gospel transformed heart. And how we use our time, talent, and treasure shows what's dear to our hearts. When heaven is nothing more than some faraway place that is given little thought other than maybe when there's a funeral, and oh yeah, they're in a better place, and we just start talking about heaven then, or when we're inside the church, maybe it comes up in a sermon, or we're thinking we're going to die, maybe a car accident, an airplane, or an illness, all of a sudden we start thinking about heaven. Otherwise, we hardly think about it. Then it's understandable why so many believers are not passionate about going there. And if you're not passionate about going there, you're certainly not going to be diligent and work hard to store treasures there. If you don't see that as your real home, and you don't see this life as simply, we're just pilgrims passing through, we're just soldiers stationed here by our master, and He's going to call us back home someday. If you don't have that kind of mindset, and you get so focused and caught up in this world, you're not going to desire, you're not going to long for, you're not going to strive after, you're not going to live for heaven. Jesus pointed out why it's important to deposit treasures in heaven when He said in Matthew 6:21, "For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." We won't be passionate about anything if our heart is not in it. Commenting on this, D.A. Carson wrote, "The point is that the things most highly treasured occupy the heart, the center of the personality. They embrace the mind, emotions, and will, and thus the most cherished treasure subtly but without fail controls the whole person's direction and values." The things we treasure capture our hearts, our attention. They cause us to think about them, to treasure them, to long for them, to work for them. We wake up thinking about them. We go through the day. Maybe we're doing our job, but our hearts go to the things we treasure. So during the day, do you think, oh, I can't wait to get that next new cell phone? Mine is so old already. Or, oh, I want a bigger house, or I want the promotion at work, and that's all you think about. It owns you rather than you owning. That's the treasure that consumes you. That's going to reveal to you where your heart is. But if you're pattern of thinking is mostly, what can I do with my resources for God's kingdom and His glory? I desperately want my coworker to know Him. I can tell you, I'm sure we all have these long lists. I want my father to know Jesus. My brother doesn't know Jesus. I got two best friends I grew up with in the States that don't know Jesus. I pray for them continually. My wife's parents, all her siblings, I pray for them regularly. My panganay does not know the Lord. It's continually weighing on my heart. And I keep thinking, Lord, give me opportunities. Give me boldness. Those are the type of things that need to be our gospel reflex. Lord, there are countries just an hour flight away, or we could take a ferry to, where they don't know you. Very few Christians. I'm going to Cambodia in 2 weeks. Very small percentage of Christians. They were, Hindus, I think, first for thousands of years. Now they're mostly Buddhists. Very few Christians. Malaysia, I was there a few months ago. Very small percentage of believers. China, so many people, but relatively small amount of believers. Indonesia, I'm not even getting into the Arabic countries. This should concern us. There are people in this world that are lost and dying without Jesus. We can't be so focused on the little things we have in our temporal time in this world that we don't seek God. How can I, in some way, impact this world for your kingdom? In light of Matthew 6:21, where Jesus said, where your treasure is, there your heart will be also, Paul wrote in Colossians 3:1-2, if then you have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above, where Christ is. And He's seated at the right hand of God. Set your mind on the things that are above, not on the things that are on earth. If our greatest joy and security are found in the things we buy, or our joy and security is found in what we achieve or what we earn, then desiring, thinking about, and preparing for a future with God in heaven is not going to be the foremost on our minds. It's going to get little attention, and it's going to get little action. Jesus said in Matthew 6:21, if we're focusing on heaven and our treasures there, then our heart will be there. When our heart's joy is to intentionally, consistently, and sacrificially use our time, talent, and treasure to reach the nations for Jesus Christ, we will receive rewards in the world to come. It's interesting that Jesus said in the last book, in the last chapter of the last book of the Bible, in Revelation 22, verse 12, behold, I am coming quickly, and my reward is with me to render to every man and to every woman according to what they have done. So we've been looking at three compelling reasons why we should be investing in God's kingdom. Let me get this up again. Investments made in this world only yield temporary results. They're going to perish with this world. But investments made in God's kingdom will yield eternal rewards. And investments made in God's kingdom will reveal our love for God and will motivate us to love Him and serve Him more. Remember, we cannot be so earthly minded that we're no heavenly good. So we can invest in God's kingdom by making Him known in Cainta, in Manila, in Luzon, throughout the Philippines, and to the ends of the world. We can invest in His kingdom by supporting the ministry of missions and evangelism. Not only supporting, but doing it where the Lord takes us. And we can use our time, talents, and treasure to store up eternal glory by caring for those in need, first in the church, then in our families, and then those outside for God's glory and not our own. This may involve giving up things for God, but as someone observed, I'll leave you with this last thought. Treasures in heaven are laid up only when treasures on earth are laid down. Let me say that one last time. Treasures in heaven are laid up only when treasures on earth are laid down. And Lord, I thank you that you give us the privilege and the opportunity to work for eternal things. And I pray that would not be our duty, but our delight, to be used by you to expand your kingdom, to spread your fame, to make you known to a lost and dying world, and to build up the saints and to love our neighbors for your glory. I thank you for this in Jesus' name. Amen.